Broadcasting Company invites you by transcription to join The Chase. There is always the hunter and the hunted, the pursuer and the pursued. It may be the voice of authority, or a race with death and destruction, the most relentless of the hunters. There are times when laughter is heard as counterpoint, and moments when sheer terror is the theme. But always there is the chase. And the chase is strange indeed when the one you're so desperately following is you.
Have you ever tried to find yourself? I'm not trying to be facetious. Most of us know exactly who we are from the time we're old enough to memorize our names. And so did I, for a while. But then something happened. Something white and blinding and hot that shriveled up my memory and left me with what? Nothing. With an empty space where my past had been. And a future devoted solely to the pursuit of my own identity. It started for me in a hospital bed on a gray December morning. I seemed to awake behind a filmy curtain of gauze with a mind that was enshrouded in darkness.
Pulse 92, blood pressure 140 over 8, temperature normal. Not too bad.
What?
Oh, you're awake.
Yes, I think so.
How do you feel?
I don't know.
I'm Dr. Scott.
Dr. Scott? Am I ill?
You were for 16 weeks.
Where am I now?
The General Hospital. Seems to me you've been here since they laid the cornerstone.
What happened to me? Do I have all this gauze on my head?
You were hit by a car, squarely. Incidentally, it was your own fault. You were crossing the street against the lights while intoxicated.
Oh.
Now, perhaps you'd like to introduce yourself.
You mean you don't know who I am?
No. Do you?
Why, of course.
Fine. Who are you?
I'm... But this is ridiculous. I mean, I know who I am.
I'm afraid you don't. A nurse, Luminol, half grain. Thank you. Here. Take this with water.
What is it?
Something to keep you calm while we talk. That's a good chap. Now, listen to me. I think you're well enough to understand the facts. First of all, you're suffering from amnesia. You've had a complete blackout. At the moment, neither of us knows just who you are or where you came from.
Oh, but my clothes. Wasn't there any identification in my clothes?
When we picked you up, you were wearing a shirt and a pair of trousers. That's all. You'd lost your overcoat and jacket somewhere.
You've never been able to identify me?
No. You've been in and out of the ether 3 times since the accident. But this is the first time you've been rational enough to answer questions.
I've been operated on 3 times.
Yes.
For what?
Plastic surgery on your face.
My face?
Nurse, start removing his bandages, please.
My face?
Now, don't get excited. It's an excellent job, if I say so myself. You'd been hit pretty hard. But Dr. Lawrence happened to be around at the time, and together we patched your face up fairly well. You may not look quite as you looked before the accident, but we've given you a pretty good substitute, particularly after the scars healed. All right, we've finished. Now suppose you have a look at yourself in this mirror. Well?
I don't know what to say.
Do you like your new profile?
How do I know? I can't compare it with the old one.
Ha, good. Sense of humor is always an indication of progress in a patient. Now, never mind the scars. They'll grow fainter in time.
Well?
That's that.
You mean I'm discharged?
In about a week.
And then what?
Then I'm afraid you've got a problem. You've got to find out just who you are.
Well, won't my memory return?
It's doubtful. In your case, there was brain injury. We've tried to find out something about you, but we haven't been successful.
You've tried to locate my friends, my family?
Yes. You're not a criminal, at any rate. Your fingerprints aren't on file. But other than that, I'm afraid we haven't had much luck.
I see.
The man who hit you asked if you'll accept a settlement. He offers $5,000 in cash and payment of all medical expenses.
From what you tell me, it was all my fault. He's very generous.
I understand he can afford it. At any rate, it'll send you out of here with some money in your pocket, and that's something. How do you feel?
Physically, I'm all right.
And mentally?
Like a newborn baby. It should be interesting to find out who I am and what I am, Dr. Scott. It should be almost like a search, a chase. For a phantom. Little did I know what was in store for me, nor did I realize what kind of a hunt I was attempting. But a week later, I was ready to leave my hospital bed, and as I finished dressing...
We've bought a jacket and overcoat for you. I think it's your size. Oh, incidentally, do you recognize those trousers?
No.
Well, I didn't expect you to, but sometimes there are minor things that... Well, good luck, Mr. By the way, what do you intend to call you?
I suppose Smith is as good a name as any other. John?
What is it?
Yeah, that name, John, has a familiar ring to it. What's this?
You found something?
A ticket in the watch pocket of my trousers. It's a pawn ticket.
Oh?
This may give me a clue, Dr. Scott.
Perhaps.
It's a pawn shop on 2nd Avenue.
Do you know where 2nd Avenue is? Can you find your way around the city?
Oh, I'm sure I can. Oddly enough, I feel familiar about everything but myself.
Not so odd as you think. Well, I'll say goodbye now. Let me know how you make out, Mr. Smith. And let's hope that what you find at the end of your chase was worthwhile hunting for.
Yes?
I want to redeem an article.
Your ticket, please?
Here you are.
Just a moment. You're Mr. Jonathan Fawcett?
Yes.
One rawhide suitcase. $23.50, including interest.
Oh, yes. Here you are.
I'll give you a receipt.
Never mind the receipt.
Are you sure your name is Fawcett?
I'm positive.
Sign here.
Sign?
Signature's the same. We've got to be careful, you know. So many people... just a second! You forgot your change!
I carried the suitcase to a railway station, then found a secluded spot in the waiting room and opened it. Inside, I found a suit of clothes, a change of linen, and a loaded revolver. I found a letter in the inside pocket of the suit, addressed to Jonathan Fawcett, and written by a man named Edward Croydon.
Dear John, this letter will be short and to the point. I merely want to give you a bit of advice. Get rid of yourself. The world will be a great deal better off without you. If you have one spark of decency left, you'll blow your rotten brains out and give Nancy a chance to lead a happy life. You're not fit to wipe her shoes. With the fond hope of seeing your name in the obituary column very shortly, I remain Edward Croydon.
There was a letterhead, the address of a midtown office building, and I made that the next stop in the
pursuit of my own identity.
You wish to see me?
You're Mr. Edward Croydon?
I am.
Well, my name is Smith, John Smith.
How unusual.
I was wondering if you could give me a bit of information in regard to a friend of mine.
Who?
Jonathan Fawcett.
He may be a friend of yours, but he's no friend of mine, I can assure you.
Can you tell me something about him?
Yes. He was an incurable drunk, for one thing. For another, he was completely untrustworthy. Unfortunately, I couldn't attend his funeral. It would have been a pleasure.
You mean he's dead?
Apparently. His coat and topcoat were found floating in the river some 4 months ago. How well did you know him?
Well, he owed me a bit of money.
Just a bit? He owed me a fortune. Or I should say, he cheated me out of a fortune. He was my business partner. I trusted him completely at one time, but he cheated me, tried to ruin me. And I stood for it all, up to a point, because of his wife.
His wife? What is she like?
Nancy? One has to know Nancy Fawcett to appreciate her. The man pretended he couldn't live without her. He begged and he whined and he pleaded. And he did have a certain physical charm. Later, she found he only married her for money. A small inheritance her father had left her. When that was gone, Fawcett reverted to his normal self. Or, I should say, his abnormal self. And proceeded to see how quickly he could drive her into her grave.
Well, where can I find his wife?
You want to talk to Nancy Fawcett?
If I may.
Now look here, Mr. Smith. Don't annoy Nancy with any of Jonathan's petty troubles. What did the man owe you? I'll pay you off myself.
No, it's not the money. I won't mention that to her.
Then what is it?
Well, I'm just curious to find out if Jonathan Fawcett was as bad as you painted him.
So far, everything I've told you has been an understatement. You know, there's something familiar about you, Mr. Smith.
Is there?
It's not your face. I know I've never seen you before. But there's something about your voice.
We've been talking so much about Jonathan Fawcett, perhaps my voice reminds you of his.
That's it, exactly.
Well, you have been very helpful, Mr. Croydon. I'd appreciate one more thing. Would you give me Jonathan Fawcett's address?
You're determined to see his wife, are you?
I would like to. You see, I knew Fawcett very well. Better than you did, as a matter of fact. I have a more or less personal interest in his history.
All right. Here, I'll jot Nancy's address down for you.
Well, that's very kind of you.
Now, please don't upset her. She's been through enough.
No, I'll be very careful.
There you are.
Thank you. Goodbye, Mr. Croydon.
I'm going out myself right now. Would you care to have a drink with me at the bar downstairs?
No, thank you. No, I'm rather in a hurry.
Then I'll have one myself. Every afternoon at this time for the past 4 months, I've drunk a toast all by myself.
To what, Mr. Croydon?
To Jonathan Fawcett's death.
I left him on the street a few minutes later. And when I turned away, for a moment I felt I shouldn't go on. What was I searching for? What would I find? I'd heard enough so far to convince me that what I was hunting might be more wisely left alone. But now that I'd started, I couldn't stop. I had to know exactly where this pursuit for a lost man's identity would lead. So a short time later, I found myself in front of a small suburban house, just outside the city limits.
Yes?
Are you Mrs. Nancy Fawcett?
Yes, I am.
My name is Smith, John Smith. I knew your husband.
Jonathan? Oh, please come in. The house is kind of messy at the moment. I'm afraid I haven't had time.
No, it's quite all right. It looks fine to me.
Please sit down.
Oh, thank you.
You say you knew Jonathan?
Yes.
You never mentioned your name.
It was a long time ago when we were friends.
Friends? I didn't think Jonathan had any friends.
Why do you say that?
Because he seemed to have dedicated his life to making enemies.
How long were you married?
5 years.
Were they happy years?
The most miserable I've ever spent.
I see.
I shouldn't talk this way to a stranger.
But I'm not a stranger.
No?
I mean, I knew Jonathan perhaps even better than you did.
You were that close?
As close as two people could be at one time.
Then you must have seen his better nature.
Did he have one?
For me, at certain moments. It wasn't what he did or said I could bear that. It was the loathing he had for everything that was fine. Everything that was decent and civilized. It was almost as if Jonathan was insane.
He may have been.
Yes, he may have been.
Did you love him?
I thought I did, once. Why are you so interested in Jonathan's past? Mr. Smith, he's gone now. There's no bringing him back.
Well, I'm looking for facts, for a novel. You see, I'm a writer.
Oh.
I feel that he'd make a good story. I'm in search of material, more or less.
Then I suggest you forget about my husband.
Why?
Because what he was, the surface he presented to the world, wasn't fit to put into print. It was only what may have been beneath that was worthwhile.
What may have been beneath? You found something worthwhile in him, then.
There must have been something. I was in love with him once.
Do you have a photograph?
Of Jonathan?
Yes.
I have one in this drawer. Taken 3 years ago. It was taken at a time when... when I hoped things would be different. I knew later that they'd never be different. Jonathan was what he was, and nothing would ever change him.
So this was Jonathan Fawcett.
Don't you recognize him?
Oh, yes, of course. It's just that I hadn't seen him in so long.
It's an excellent likeness.
I can see that. Vanity and conceit. Cruelty is obvious in the mouth and the eyes.
You knew Jonathan very well.
Intimately.
It was a short time after that picture was taken that I found out about Rita.
Rita?
Yes, he'd taken up with another woman. She was coarse and common.
Why didn't you leave him when you found out about this Rita?
I don't know.
What if he came back?
I don't want him to come back. I never want to see Jonathan Fawcett again, as long as I live.
Before I go, could you tell me where I could get in touch with Rita?
Well, that shouldn't be difficult. She's well known in certain circles. Her last name's Hagen. I think she has a flat in the 40s somewhere.
I'll find her. Now I'll say goodbye.
Goodbye, mister.
What are you staring at?
There was just something I thought I'd noticed.
I'd better leave. Thank you for everything, Mrs. Fawcett.
No, wait, I...
Yes?
I just wanted to know where I could reach you, Mr. Smith.
Reach me? Why?
In case I want to.
But what for?
Well, I may have more to tell you about Jonathan for your book, you know.
It might be better if you never saw me again, Mrs. Fawcett.
Please, just as a favor.
I'm staying in a small hotel downtown, the Metro.
Yes, I think I know where it is.
I doubt if I'll be there very long. I intend to go away.
I see. Well, all the best to you, Mr. Smith.
And to you, Mrs. Fawcett. All the happiness that Jonathan failed to give you. Goodbye. Have you ever looked for someone you didn't want to find? Have you ever run after a nightmare? I seem to be doing that now because every fact I uncovered, every voice I heard, carried me deeper and deeper into a revelation I loathed. But I was determined to carry this chase straight through to its finish. For Pandora's box was open, and I'd thrown away the key.
All right, hold your horses. Who is it?
Jonathan Fawcett.
Jonathan? Thing. What kind of joke are you, anyway? You trying to scare me to death?
Sorry, I was being funny.
You got a queer sense of humor, mister. What do you want?
Are you Rita Hagen?
Who wants to know?
My name is Smith.
What are you selling, cork drops?
You mind if I come in?
I'm busy drinking. Come back some other time.
Oh, please, this is very important.
All right, come on. But I'm throwing you out in 5 minutes. I got a heavy date. Oh, you're in. start talking.
I understand you are a friend of Jonathan Fawcett's.
A friend? Cut it out. You get me hysterical.
Well, you knew him, didn't you?
Like a book, mister. The bum.
Tell me about him.
Why?
Because I'm interested.
Well, I'm not. He was a no-good stinker with a hunk of dry ice where his heart should have been. He's dead, ain't he? Good. Let's leave sleeping dogs lie. And, mister, I mean dogs.
Was he in love with you?
Righty, you got to ask so many personal questions, sweetie pie.
Well, it's a legal matter. Here, I'll make it worth your while.
Mm-hmm. 50 bucks. Well, that's different.
Now, tell me all you know about Jonathan.
Sure. He was a rat. A no-good, double-crossing rat. He chiseled his wife, he chiseled his friends, and he chiseled me. He was out for everything he could get, no holds barred.
Did he fall in love with you?
A lying, two-faced slob. He said he wanted to marry me. Then I find out about his wife. After that, he tells he's going to leave his wife. And like a sucker, I believe him. But I didn't figure on how he was planning to do it.
What do you mean?
You ain't a cop by any chance.
No, I just want some information on Fawcett. Whatever you tell me will be kept in strictest confidence.
You know, I'm beginning to like you, Smithy.
Let's concentrate on Jonathan for a while, shall we?
Concentrate on him? I'd like to kill him. That story, ain't it? The jig's already dead. Oh, bottle's empty. Poor little bottle, all gone dry. Well, Mama can buy herself a case full of Papa's 50 bucks. Hmm?
You were starting to tell me about Jonathan and how he was going to leave his wife.
Yeah. He said he wanted to get rid of her.
What do you mean?
How does it sound, you stupid cluck? How would a man get rid of a woman without divorcing her?
You mean murder?
Now, that's a bright little boy. You're getting real smart, Junior.
He actually told you that he was going to kill his wife?
But I was having no part of it. He took a dive in the river anyway, before even you was the rot he showed me.
Oh, that was why he had the gun.
Huh?
They discovered a suitcase belonging to Fawcett in a pawn shop. There was a gun inside it with some clothes.
A closer for a getaway, and the gun was for Nancy Fawcett. But he needed a drink, I guess. Well, Les needed a drink so bad he forgot all about what he was going to do, and he hocked his thing.
Was he going to kill his wife because of you?
Me?
I mean because he loved you?
No. No, it wasn't for me. It was for a measly 5,000 bucks, you hear? The murderous bum was going to kill her for her insurance. Oh, that was silly. Now I'll have to clean it up. I better cut down on the alky. It's going to my head. What's the matter?
Jonathan Fawcett. What a mess he made of his life.
What difference does it make now? Slug is dead. Let's leave him lying quietly where he is. Deep down his watery grave.
You're right, Rita.
Hmm?
Let's leave him where he is. For good. Was finished. I'd found out all I wanted to know about Jonathan Fawcett. What I discovered revolted me. The search was over. I'd ended up with less than I started. If I could do it over again, I wondered, what would I wish for? Well, the answer was obvious. I'd wish they hadn't saved my miserable life. I wish they'd left me lying there in the gutter where Jonathan Fawcett belonged. I returned to my room and opened the suitcase once more. Beneath the folds of my suit lay the revolver, the weapon that Jonathan Fawcett had purchased to murder his wife. But why was I speaking in the third person? I was Jonathan Fawcett, and I still am. I was the wretch whose death was celebrated by so many. I had to make sure that Jonathan Fawcett that I, as I was, would never return. It was the one decent act I could accomplish. The one clean spot in a filthy career. And it took so little to manage it. Just a lift of the muzzle. So, against my head. And a slight pressure of the trigger. So very slight. Who is it?
It's Nancy Fawcett. May I see you, please?
Come in.
What's happened?
Nothing. Why do you ask?
You look so pale.
Why have you come here?
There's something I had to ask, and I had to have an answer.
What is it?
Is your name really Smith? Or is it...
What are you looking at?
There's a gun on the table.
What about it?
No, you couldn't have thought of doing a thing like that.
I was only cleaning it, that's all.
Where did you get that ring you're wearing?
Ring?
Jonathan had a ring like that. That's why I had to see you again. You are...
Jonathan Fawcett is dead. You must believe that. Once and for all, Nancy.
Well, then... There's no need for the gun, is there?
The gun?
There's no point in wiping out what doesn't exist.
No point at all.
You're John Smith. You'll always be John Smith. What's happened has happened. Let's be thankful for what we have.
Nancy.
We're wasting time. So much to be done. What are we waiting for? I'm sure we can find a cab, John. That is, if you intend to take me home.
Animal world, there is the hunter and the hunted, hound and fox, hawk and sparrow, cat and mouse. We in the topmost species have also joined the hunt. But who is to judge precisely which of us are hounds or foxes as we enter the chase? The Chase was created and written for the National Broadcasting Company by Lawrence Cleve. Featured in tonight's cast were Don McLaughlin and Joan Tompkins. Others in the cast were Linda Watkins, Ned Weaver, and William Keane. The Chase is directed and transcribed by Fred Way. Fred Collins speaking. Next week, a hunter pursues the most dangerous game in the world on The Chase.
Tonight is Adventure with Dragnet and Barry Craig, confidential investigator, on